Good afternoon and a very warm welcome to you. My name is Jeannie D and this is Afternoon Express.
Welcome indeed. I'm Bonnie Mbuli. Now, today we're talking about a very misunderstood condition called endometriosis. Yeah. And earlier on, you interviewed Millen Magese.
Yeah, she's the most phenomenal
actress.
She
shared her incredible
story. Such an amazing interview. Her story is beautiful.
Yeah.
But we are covering a lot of women's issues today. We're also discussing, we're going to be discussing something that is so close to my heart. We are dispelling all of the kind of myths and stuff around cervical cancer. We've got Dr. Carol Thomas in the loft, and we're going to be discussing that as well.
And earlier on, you were sharing an interesting story that trended about a boy who said something quite ignorant about
something that I'm really passionate about, and I've been trying to work with a whole bunch of charities to try and get, you know, the fact that there's so many condoms being, you know, spread around in schools and given away in schools where girls don't have access to sanitary towels, tampons and all of that. But today we have the founder of the Mina Cup, which we're going to be chatting to as well today. It's such a great idea and an amazing solution for the shortage of sanitary towels and tampons for young ladies.
Absolutely, and because it's Breast Cancer Awareness Month. In fact, there's only a few days left until the end of the month. Clicks is offering free breast cancer examinations.
Amazing.
Between 1 and 5 p.m. at all their Helping Hands Trust clinics for women without medical aid. So go over there and get your breasts examined before the month is over.
Yeah, exactly. Now, obviously this week I started a brand new diet. Health food, grilled fish, veggies, and then you must see what they're making in the kitchen. It's my nightmare.
Oh yes, we have been scheming. Good afternoon, South Africa, and welcome to Afternoon Express. In the kitchen with me today, I've got two very special people. Susie O'Regan joins us in the studio today. I'm so excited to have you back because I walked into Woolies the other day to go and buy regular milk for all the smoothies in the morning, and the packaging had changed. And you've got all the details for us today on why that's all changed. So if you guys want to know exactly why Woolies has got a brand new packaging with their green labels, all those details coming up later on Afternoon Express. And because it's all changed and Jeannie was on a diet, I thought, why not only make one, but two desserts on the show today?
Absolutely.
Kalenzo, how are you?
I'm very well, how are you?
I'm very good. It's been a long time since we cooked together.
Great to be back, man. So today we're making an interesting honey milk panna cotta with some fresh berries, two different types of honeys. It's going to be really delicious.
That sounds so amazing. Honey panna cotta with a little bit of milk thrown in there. It's going to be absolutely amazing. Don't forget to get all the recipe details on your mobile device by SMSing the keyword dessert to 33650. It'll cost you 1.50 and your free SMSs do not apply. But all the details on how to make it a little bit later on right here on Afternoon Express. Now let's have it this side because this looks amazing. It looks like breakfast, but in a dessert.
Yeah, so I thought, every time my guests come over, and I'm in a quick spin, I'm like, what do I make? So I thought, let's do a healthier version of a lemon meringue pie. So we're making a granola.
Oh, wow.
Lemon meringue.
Do we get to make our own granola?
We make everything from scratch.
Yes, amazing. So we're going to have lots of fun in the kitchen today. If you want to get cooking with us, make sure you tune into the show. This recipe will be on our website, afternoonexpress.co.za. You can make it along with us right here on Afternoon Express. It's like always, people always say that after like a night out, you have pizza, it's best the next day. This is one of those things you can have for dessert at night and have for breakfast the next morning.
Exactly.
Just as good. Over to you, ladies.
We're now joined by Dr. Carol Thomas, who's a multi-award-winning and celebrated specialist gynaecologist. Today shed some light on cervical cancer, which can affect as many as one in every 42 women in South Africa.
And sometimes more. Welcome, Dr. Carol,
to
the show.
Thank you very much for having me.
Firstly, what is the link between HPV and cervical cancer?
Well, it's one that's relatively recent, but when I was a student, we were told that there were rogue sperm that could cause cervical cancer, or if you lay on a wet blanket, that could also cause cervical cancer, which really meant that we really didn't know what was going on.
Yeah.
But in the last few decades, they've identified that certain types of human papilloma virus, or wart virus, can actually cause changes 20 years after you've been infected with the virus. Now, there are more than 100 of them, but there are two of them, number 16 and 18, they all have numbers that cause most of the trouble for cervical cancer.
Wow, but what is HPV?
Oh, sorry.
How is it contracted? Is it an STD?
It is a sexually transmitted disease, although it is a contact virus. So we carry it on our hands and we carry it on other parts of our bodies.
Wow.
And so it's for the same reason. Michael Douglas, for example, said that he got
throat
cancer from having oral sex.
Yeah.
He did very well until he said that, because he could have been a poster boy for HPV disease.
Wow.
But I think he said that that in fact you could do better by having more oral sex. So it is transmitted by contact, and until we all use total body condoms, we are okay. all at risk.
Yeah. But if you get cervical cancer, does it mean because it's from an STD?
Yes, for most of it, and okay. there are some unexplained, but for 60 to 90% of all cervical cancers, there will be an associated human papillomavirus infection, of which about 70% will be due to number 16 and 18, which is what the vaccines are about.
What's the success rate of treating cervical cancer? Yeah.
It depends on when you find it. I mean, it's inculcated in us that we should be having annual pap smears. It need not be annual because it depends on your profile. For example, young women who have been vaccinated against HPV only need their first pap smear at about 25. And then perhaps 5 yearly.
Right.
But the problem is that we're never sure when people become sexually active. And with a high rate of sexual abuse in this country and elsewhere in the world, one has to individualize things as much as possible.
Yeah.
But mainly it's contracted sexually. But unlike where it goes with bodily fluids, it is actually about contact and repeated contact.
Wow.
Our cervices or the mouth of the womb is much more vulnerable than elsewhere. And so when we hear of an abnormal pap smear, people immediately think that they have cancer. But often that simply means that we are ahead of the curve by a few years before you would develop cancer which invades the rest of the mouth.
So it is possible that people have HPV but never develop cervical cancer.
90% of women who carry the high-risk type, if 100 women are infected, 90 of them will not, but there's a persistent infection in 10% of women, and that's the group that you need to find and target. It's interesting that you mentioned the Breast Awareness Month. Yeah. Not many people are aware that there is actually a cervical cancer month, and it's September. But it's not as attractive, doesn't have a pink ribbon, doesn't have high profile.
No, but it needs just as much profile. It needs just as much media attention. Absolutely.
Because it depends on which cancer registry you look at in this country.
Right.
Breast cancer and cervical cancer are about equal in the in numbers and in how many people they affect.
But there is a vaccination against HPV.
This is correct. There's a lot of...
So it, and how early can women then cervical cancer?
It does, and we believe that it will. It has been around for just over a decade. And because I've said cervical cancer takes 20 years to develop, we use other means of checking the how well it works.
Yeah.
For example, how many times are you called back for pap smears? In Australia, it's been very effective in that they've almost eliminated the need for intervention, checking cervix, taking biopsy.
I think every young girl needs that injection.
Yeah. What would make the onslaught of it prevalent or more likely?
There are other cofactors. Are you saying the vaccine or cervical cancer?
Cervical cancer.
Some get it and why not?
Yeah. Others. We're not
what
very.
Conditions
we don't really know. But smoking is a big cofactor. So for smokers who are HPV positive, particularly those that are high risk, that would be a good intervention not to use that.
Yeah.
And that's
amongst
one of
many other reasons.
Absolutely. Yeah. And if you are how your immunity. Yeah. Is depressed, as with HIV infection, your risk of developing cervical cancer because your immune system is not good enough is higher, and a lot of good work's been done about that.
So your depression affects your immune system as well?
Your immune suppression will, HPV and HIV go together and more rapidly when they coexist.
You are amazing. This is such an important conversation to have, and I really hope that all young women across the country are listening to the show today. We're going to be back with you in a little while again with more questions. We're like attacking you with questions today. Over to you, Danilo.
Yeah, speaking of everybody that should be impacted by this conversation, I hope you're going to be able to share with us online. We'd love to hear your thoughts and opinions. Today, particularly on Facebook, there's a question we're asking you. It said, should women get time off work when they have their menstrual cycle? Go and find that post post on our Facebook page and go and give it a quick answer. I'd love to hear your thoughts and opinions on this. Really, a lot of South Africans have sent through their comments through to this one. So find us on Facebook. It's Afternoon Express and use the official hashtag Afternoon Express. We'd love to hear your thoughts and opinion. Should women get time off from work when they have their menstrual cycles? What are your thoughts? Also, during the ad break, don't forget to get your spatulas out and put your sweet tooth in. We're making a milk and honey panna cotta. Welcome back to Afternoon Express live on SABC3. So we're in the kitchen today at the moment, and it's time for us to start with a product that I was so shocked by recently in the mall. I went into my favorite Woolies down the road and I walked inside the mall and I was like, I need to buy milk for, you know, my smoothie in the morning. And I was always wondering, like, what had happened to the original bottle? So I took it to the store manager and I was like, dude, is this still the normal same thing that I was drinking? He's like, yes, sir, just the packaging has changed. And so I've roped in Susie O'Regan into the loft with us today to tell us more about this. Tell me more about the milestone. What a cool initiative.
Okay, well, it completely talks to Woolworths Good Business Journey program, where we are constantly looking at innovative and responsible packaging solutions.
Okay.
So what we've done with this, it's been a long journey, but we have incorporated 30% plant-based plastic into our fresh milk bottles. So the plants that are used is sugarcane. Sugarcane, as you know, grows every year. It's a renewable energy source. So unlike fossil fuels, which take millions of years to form and then immediately get used up, sugarcane is renewable.
Sure.
So in all our fresh milk bottles, we've got 30% plant plastic.
Okay, so that milestone has been the reason why you've changed the color to green of all the labels for now. Just to tell everyone in South Africa, hello, we're doing something 100%. Amazing here. Like, take a look.
So as you can see, the milk bottle itself is exactly the same. It's 100% recyclable. It looks the same. It feels the same. And the way that we want to convey that, the new initiative, was to put the green sleeve on the bottle. Okay. So,
what about auntie or uncle or myself who walked into the Woolies, was like, is this the same product? Like, how do we know that the same thing is on the inside?
It's completely the same. Okay. It has exactly, I mean, it's our fresh Ayrshire milk, regular milk, organic milk, lactose-free milk. It is exactly the same. Okay. So just to help you to navigate, I mean, the lid colours are the same. So if you want full cream, you go for the blue lid. And And then there is just a lovely story on the side of the bottle that explains what we have done, and you can go onto the Woolworths website, www.woolworths.co/greenbottle, and read the full story.
Cool, so it's woolworths.co.za/greenbottle. I also noticed what's really cool. I don't know if you guys are able to see this. I'm going to try and see if I can hold one up for you. But on this on the back here, you know, if you're on Twitter and you've got those new emojis, if you send a green heart to the Woolworths Twitter account, which is Woolworths SA, and you can use that, well, you can use the hashtag there if you'd want to, but they'll send you all the information you need to know about the campaign. It's really, really cool the fact you guys have done this and created a sustainable product now, which is also awesome because the product stays the same on the inside, and then eventually you said these labels are going to change back to something slightly different.
Yeah. So probably in about February time, we'll revert back to the sort of cream-coloured sleeve, but we will retain the green heart.
Cool.
So that you know it's still the green journey that we're on, and it's still the 30% plant-based plastic.
And remind me of that phrase, it's drink milk and...
Drink milk with tomorrow in mind.
Drink milk with tomorrow in mind. That's exactly what we're going to do in Afternoon Express today. So, Susie, thank you so much. We're not only going to be drinking milk, we're going to be making a delicious dessert using milk. It's called a milk and honey panna cotta. Do you know what a panna cotta is?
Of course I do. I'm making one.
Okay, let's go. Good to have you in the lot with us.
Dude,
let's get cooking.
It's exciting to be here. So, what we're going to start with our panna cotta base, our all-time favorite Woolies milk.
Would be nice if it was flavored, right? We could all have it.
So what I'm doing here is putting some milk into the pot.
Cool.
I turn on the stove, and while that is warming up, I'm just gonna take a bit of gelatine. Mm-hmm. So some gelatine leaves, you know with gelatine, you need to soak it a little bit in some water. So I'm just gonna take this in.
You've got two sleeves there.
It's actually four. So,
four leaves in there. Okay.
So this panna cotta actually goes a long way. It needs to be solid. It needs to be
dense.
Stiff. Yeah,
okay, which is interesting. Okay.
Awesome. So sweeten things up. A bit of brown sugar that goes in there. Crack of salt. Mm-hmm. You know, salt enhances
all the sweetness.
Enhances the flavors.
Mm-hmm.
Here I've got some Woolies vanilla extract. Please don't use vanilla essence.
Okay. Why?
Yeah. No. It's not a great product. You use the extract. You get the beautiful flavors of vanilla, and Woolies has a great product there for us.
Cool.
Here I've got some creamed honey from Woolies. Mm. So I'm not even going to skim. I'm going to put everything in.
Oh, it's like one of those honey butters that you can buy. They exactly. are so insane. I mean, not too long ago, I was at one of the wine farms, and they served literally just honey butter or something like this, like honey cream on a rye toast. It is like the most incredible breakfast treat. It's so delicious.
My goodness, that sounds absolutely delicious. So while that is heating up, so I stir it, make sure everything is happy, gelling
properly.
Together. Once that is warm and my gelatin is sponged, I squeeze the excess liquid out, add that to my warm liquid and stir that.
Okay,
so that
the
incorporates in. Once I'm done with this, I pour it into a serving dish. Okay. So do you want to grab one for me there at the
sure.
back?
Sure. Do you want a finished one or an empty one?
You can give me the finished one so we can show our viewers the consistency that we want. Voila.
And this is how you show consistency, Clem told me. If it wiggles, it's warm. Or if it wiggles, it's, I don't know, whatever. So, we just like things that wiggle in this loft, okay?
So you see, it's quite stiff, it's there, it's panna cotta, it's ready to be enjoyed. So once you do that, you pour that into your serving dish, let that
Delicious.
Chill 4 to 6 hours overnight if you want it to be a great consistency.
Yummy.
And now we decorate.
Cool, let's decorate.
So I've got some fresh cut strawberries here that I'm just going to put over here. So I cut them in different shapes and sizes. Some are quarter,
Yummy.
Some are cut in slices.
So it's basically hide all the delicious sweetness with what we call health on top of it, and then we all think that we're eating something deliciously healthy.
This is for Ginny. You know, I'm doing this for Ginny.
For her diet.
Exactly.
Yeah, exactly.
Exactly. Some fresh mint, you know, some extra color. Put the whole thing on.
Delicious. Yeah, just throw all those leaves on there.
All
Why
the leaves
not?
On. And that, my friend, is
not delicious.
Yummy.
Describe it better than I did. Describe it to make us drool.
A yummy, creamy, sweet, scrumptious honey and milk panna cotta.
Yummy. So if you guys want to get that recipe for the delicious, decadent, yummy milk and honey panna cotta on your mobile device, all you do is SMS the keyword dessert to 33650. It'll cost you 1.50 rand. Your free SMSs don't apply. You get a list of all the ingredients and a link to the recipe. But don't worry, if you miss how to make it, here's a recap.
Endometriosis is an often painful disorder which affects the tissue that normally lines the inside of your uterus, or the endometrium, grows outside your uterus. The condition affects an estimated 176 million women worldwide. And we're back with Dr. Carol Thomas, and we're joined now by Valencia Kippie, who is the founding member of an organization called Endometriosis Awareness, and also lives with the condition herself. Welcome to the loft.
Thank
Lovely
you so much
you
for having
us.
Me.
Thank you for coming through. Firstly, I want to know why did you decide to start the NPO, Endometriosis Awareness? What was your story with endometriosis?
My story with endometriosis was a long and difficult journey. Mm. I suffered for a long time, a number of years, in fact, for more than 12 years before I obtained a diagnosis. So it was a long journey, and my diagnosis was life-changing. And I knew then that I had two choices. I could either end up being bitter or resentful, angry for the misdiagnosis, or I could turn it around and do something positive and help other women so that their journey doesn't have to be mine.
Now, you repeatedly went for checkups and tests and it just went undetected. Why is that?
Endometriosis is a complex condition. It's not something that shows up on a scan or in your pap smear or even in a blood test.
Really?
So what they have to do in order to diagnose endometriosis is actually a procedure called a laparoscopy. So they open you, they cut you. It's a surgical procedure.
Yeah.
So that's actually the only way that you can obtain a diagnosis for endometriosis.
But why did it go for 12 years without detecting it?
It's difficult to say. Yeah. I think because of the lack of awareness out there. You know, not many people know what it is. I've seen so many specialists, and they persistently told me that, you know, the pain is all in your head.
I've also read that there's situations where birth control can suppress the symptoms of it. Doctor, is that possible?
Yes, this is true. In fact, in this very painful condition, we know that about 30% of women who start oral contraceptives to control menstrual pain, 30% of them actually have underlying endometriosis.
Oh, wow.
The problem with a delay in diagnosis, there shouldn't be, because often women will now, if they have pain, they're going to look on a search engine and they're going to check out what would this be. Of course, they may come up with all the wrong answers, but at least there's a little bit more access if you go to the web. But as Valencia has indicated, the diagnosis is an invasive procedure requiring a general anesthetic and admission to hospital. So there's often a presumptive diagnosis, and we think it could be, but let's treat you with this in the meantime. If infertility is your issue, then suppressing the egg is not going to work.
Yeah.
In fact, that's one of the treatments, is to stop the ovulation, the release of an egg every month.
Wow.
But if you're is a pregnancy, then that's counterproductive, obviously.
Absolutely. Yeah. So. And how did this condition affect your family relationships?
I often say to the ladies in the group, because we do have a support group as well, so I often say to them that endometriosis is so much, is actually so much more than just a physical condition.
Mm.
I personally believe it is a societal disease, because it impacts you in so many ways. I know of women that have lost their jobs because they're off from work so often because of the condition, and the employer just simply doesn't understand. Sex in itself for some women can be extremely painful.
Yeah.
So the partners don't always understand. So relationships get ruined because of this condition. So it's actually a lot more.
It's quite far-reaching. Yeah.
I actually interviewed a supermodel, Millen, in the beginning of the year, and I had no idea what endometriosis was about or how it affected people. And there was one part of the interview that really, really absolutely you know, impacted me on how endometriosis affected her. Let's have a look at that clip now.
For my side, they've done 13 surgeries, and that's why I'm wearing this T-shirt. You know, 13 surgeries, I don't know when it's going to stop. 13 surgeries, I'm already I'm facing infertility. 13 surgery, I'm already have two fallopian tubes blocked and one ovary down. So it's really, and even I'm sitting to you in front of you, they're asking me to remove my uterus because I have to find a way to have quality of life. Again, I do not have life. It's completely put you down to bed. She can explain more, but it is something that I think, because I'm here as somebody that I suffer with, that's why I feel like I just have to speak. You need so much of support for all these years. I had somebody who truly, her and her husband, took me as their own, expecting every year that I'll be doing two surgeries. They gave me a room, and she was here before. At the Ambomula, you know, every year they have to. She had to deal with her pregnancy and still deal with me. So if you do not have amazing family to understand, it's not something you can deal with.
Wow, it's heart-wrenching.
Yeah.
What are the symptoms of endometriosis?
You want to talk about that?
Sure, I can speak about it. Some of the symptoms that sometimes present with the condition, it's pelvic pain. That may start a week or two before your menstrual cycle. It tends to worsen during, and it may continue for days thereafter. Some women experience urinary difficulties, painful bowel movements, lower back pain, and in my case, I think chronic fatigue was the biggest symptom for me. It was a struggle to get up every morning and just get through the
day. Especially if you're a parent. I mean, I can imagine how that disrupts relationships with your children.
Yeah. Now, what work does your NPO do for endometriosis?
So the foundation is still a very new foundation. We were officially registered only in January this year. But the aim of the foundation is to raise awareness, as much awareness of the condition as possible. So I just keep talking. And I talk to anyone that will listen. someone asks me, tell me what is this thing called endo what, and I get excited because I see it as an opportunity for me to talk and to educate someone out there.
Exactly. That's amazing. Thank you so much for coming and sharing your story with
Thank
us.
Thank you so much for having
me. I really
me.
Hope that it's definitely spreading the word to all the girls. I told you, all girls in the country need to be watching the show today. Over to you, Danilo.
Sure. So it really shows you the power of having to speak out and share this information with each other. I think that's one of the most important things about social media, to be able to share messages like this. And so on the show today, on our Facebook page, we're asking you the question, should women get time off work when they have their menstrual cycles? And there's an interesting conversation and debate happening on our Facebook page currently. I'll read just a couple of those comments. One from La Zola, who says, not at all if that happens, then it'll mean that we'll be killing our economy because each and every day one is absent from work. You're costing the company thousands and then eventually millions, which is quite interesting comment. Nogotlisa says, hey everyone, well, I don't think it's necessary to get work or days off work. Hence, we have the pills to minimize pains and control the cycle, unless if that situation is maybe unbearable. And she's raising this debate to say that only if it is a circumstance where you are experiencing unbearable pains should you be taken off work. And Viana seems to agree. She says, maybe if she really needs it, depending on how bad her cycle is, the pill isn't for everyone. And Cindy and a few others saying that yes, the pill doesn't necessarily help with those pains. And so a lot of those sentiments are being shared on our Facebook page. If you'd like to join the conversation, go and find us, Afternoon Express. We'd love to hear your thoughts. We particularly want to hear your thoughts on this post right now. Should women get time off work when they have their menstrual cycle? After the break on the show, we continue our discussion on Afternoon Express.
Welcome back to Afternoon Express. We're live to you on SABC3, and today we are discussing women's health. Now, the shortage of sanitary towels in lower economic areas is a big problem in South Africa, Absolutely. Leading to many girls missing school during their period because they simply cannot afford to buy sanitary pads or tampons. Now, Zaakira Mahomed, founder of the Mina Menstrual Cup, has developed a product that hopes to solve this problem and gives hope to many girls all over the country. I love you for doing
Welcome.
This. Thank you.
It sounds like an incredible product. How did you develop it and what does it do?
Okay, so what happened was about 2 years ago, a friend of mine told me about a menstrual cup, and it obviously sounded weird. I mean, it sounded odd, it sounded strange, but she said something that stuck with me, and she said, it can last for up to 10 years. And I thought, if something can last for up to 10 years, then why are we buying sanitary towels only in August, because we get our period every month? I don't just get my period in August. So why are we only raising funds every August to buy sanitary towels to give to girls when one cup can keep her in school for her whole school career? So I did some homework, invited two of my girls, my partners in crime, to join me, Shadi and Lirato, who are not here today. And we decided, okay, let's create awareness that there is a product that's, you know, eco-friendly, after doing all our research, eco-friendly, economical, odorless, pain-free, discreet, fun. You know, you can swim with it, you can run and jump with it, you can go to gym with it, you can wear a bikini with it, and no one even knows you're menstruating.
Wow,
it's the best
genius.
Thing on earth. Yeah,
that's
I mean,
you can get a wax.
Oh yeah, you can go for laser. I can only say that because I've tried these things. You know, I went
on a plane. Of course, but you have to. But you know what? This isn't just for young girls. This is a thing that most women should be using anyway. Because isn't it better, more hygienic?
Very much more hygienic. It's made out of 100% medical grade silicone. Yeah. Our silicone comes from Germany. It's FDA approved for inserting into the body.
Yeah.
And I knew that, you know what, we're going to have a problem going into communities where the girls really need it, even though the cup is for all of us. It's the latest gadget to have in femme products.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
So it's the way of the future. And it was invented in the 1900s. The reason you and I don't know about it is because we will buy one every 5 to 10 years.
Wow. Yeah.
Right?
Exactly.
How
it's
has
not
it
making
been
money
received?
for factories.
Yeah. So what happened was I decided with my team, Brand Union took us on as a pro bono CSI project.
Yeah.
And we gave them a spec, and I said to them, okay, so we want to develop a cup that's designed especially for young girls in mind. So we tried out cups. They were very intimidating. They were scary. They were big. They were, and I said, well, if I have a problem, then the girls are going to have a problem.
Yeah.
And then we have the, you know, this social and cultural taboos regarding menstruation, the shame attached to it.
Absolutely.
You know, you need to be hidden in a room until after. You can't come, you can't cook because you're bad luck or bewitched. And
yeah,
it's happening.
Basically your life must stop. Yeah.
Exactly. So we decided, well, you know what? We need it to be fun. We want having your period to be fun.
Yeah. Okay.
Well, as much fun as
why,
can be.
Why, yeah. why is it a
all
big
things
deal?
Considered.
I mean, really, why is it a big deal? It's a natural part of growing up. Every woman, every girl, when she hits puberty, is going to get a period. You can't stop it.
Yeah.
You're giving out free condoms. You should be giving out free sanitary towels or free, you know, menstrual cups, for example. Mm. And then why are we being taxed on it? So, you know, it's all of these issues, but it's something close to all of our hearts because you can't take it away.
Yeah.
It's part of life. It's part of every day.
Yeah.
So we said to Brand Union, I said to them, look, guys, I want my cup to have a name.
Yeah.
I want it to be fun. I want it to be smart and confident. I want it to be hope in the community,
yeah.
You know. So what we did was we came up with the name Mina. So Mina means me in Zulu.
Yeah.
And Mina's your friend. She's a girl's best friend.
Yeah.
She's smart and she's confident and she wants to stay in school. And her circumstances do not define who she is.
Sure.
So what if she's from a child-headed household? So what if she's born with HIV positive? That's not her life.
Wow.
She's better than that. She's bigger than that.
Exactly.
Yeah. We believe in them. We tell our girls, we believe in you. You can be anybody you want to.
Right.
You know, and if you give love to anyone, there's no way you can't succeed in love.
Yeah. Zaakira, I love you, and you are my most, most inspirational woman at the moment, but...
So here it is. How does it work?
Okay, let me show you how it's going to work.
How user-friendly is it?
It's the best thing ever, honestly. We call it the best-kept secret in feminine hygiene, and right now it's not a secret. We want every woman to know about it. So this cup was designed especially for young girls in mind. That's why it's soft and small, and if you feel it as well, it's flexible, right?
Yeah, it is,
so
yeah.
All you do is you fold it. Fold it. There are 7 ways to fold the cup, but we don't want to complicate matters.
Okay.
This is the simplest one. This is the way I fold it. You know, you insert it into the vaginal canal. It pops open like a cup. Can you see? Like a cup. So what happens is these two holes form a suction, and it forms a seal, and then it stays stuck. It doesn't move.
Wow.
The difference between sanitary towels and tampons and menstrual cup is that the towels and the tampons absorb the blood, so it looks like you bleed that much. Just collects the blood. It doesn't affect your good bacteria when you're removing, your flow, like when you're maybe using a tampon,
right,
for example.
And how long does it last?
Okay, so the cup itself lasts 5 years. It can last up to 10 years because silicone is also very resilient. And that's who Mina is. She's resilient and she's smart and she's hopeful. And, you know, she wants to be the hope in the community.
Yeah, that's incredible.
She wants
messaging.
To come back and uplift her situation, right? So what happens, so for light flow, you could probably have to check every 5 to 6 hours.
Okay.
Yeah. Heavy flow, you'll have to empty it out more often. The greater thing about it is that, you know, we're suffering a drought right now. So even if you don't have water, you can just wipe it with a wet wipe or a tissue until you get water. The easiest way to clean it is to boil it in hot water for 5 minutes. So you don't need any special detergent, nothing.
Wow.
Nothing that's chemical. It's just natural.
Wow, I really hope that finds its way to every girl that needs one in the country.
So our target is 1 million girls.
Yeah.
What has happened is we've worked with Transnet Foundation last year and this year. So we gave them, we go to the schools and we say to them, guys, we came here to talk about your period. You know, we're talking about boys, we're talking about pimples, we're talking about pregnancy, we're talking about STDs, we're talking about stuff that's relevant that we don't talk to about our girls.
Yeah.
They need guidance. Otherwise, they're going to end up pregnant. And then we give them grants for getting pregnant. I say, let's give them grants for not getting pregnant. You know, and see what happens. So they get this journal, which is like really cute. I mean, we love Mina. We're like so crazy about Mina, right?
Mina looks like me.
Mina, she does. She actually does.
Mina Vu.
So she's this little purple girl, and it's like a journal that they can, you know, there's information on, you know, stuff that they can take home. You know, my name is Mina. I'm here to help you.
I'm going to stop you right there. Yeah. We are putting all of this information on our website. We've got to go to a commercial break, but we're going to be back with you in just a few minutes. I need to know more. We need to get our hands on Mina to give to all the girls in the country. Over to you, Danilo.
So while you're on afternoonexpress.co.za, make sure you head to our Facebook page too. We'd love to hear from you. We continue our conversation. The debate is raging on our Facebook page about women getting time off work during their menstrual cycle. The consensus seems to be that women women themselves are saying that they don't think necessarily that women should get time off. But I wanted to read two more comments that I found here that I thought were interesting to just to sort of wrap the conversation up. One is from Liesl Murray, who says, I don't think so, unless there's a chronic reason as to why. I speak for myself. I have endometriosis, and I have struggled with fertility. It's so often misdiagnosed after you spend thousands of rands on tests, but thankfully there are fertility specialists out there. The pain is at times unbearable, so perhaps some understanding from the boss for a blue day every now and again is all that's needed. And a whole bunch of women below this comment have all agreed with that sort of consensus, making sure that the bosses keep a sort of day or two available during the year for women who are going through particularly bad pains when it comes to their period. If you'd like to share your thoughts, opinions, disagree, I'm happy for you to disagree with us. We'd love to hear your thoughts and opinions on our Facebook page, Afternoon Express. Go and find the post and share your comment with us. More of this after the break.
Welcome back to Afternoon Express. You're live on SABC3. Today we're talking about a very important topic, endometriosis. And back on the couch we have Valencia Kippie and Dr. Carol Thomas. But we're taking your calls right now and we have Anonymous on the line. Hello, welcome to Afternoon Express.
Good afternoon, ladies.
How are you?
Good, thanks. And you?
Good. What's your question or comment?
Well, I have a question for Dr. Thomas. I had a hysterectomy a few years ago, and they kept my ovaries in. And my question really is, should I still be going for pap smears?
Okay. It depends entirely on why you had the hysterectomy. If it was, in fact, for something where there was abnormal cervical cells, then it is useful to every now and again at the top of the vagina, which is now called a vault, would you believe? Sounds like a bank or something. But at the vault, to take a smear very similar to a pap smear, but that would be only in some individual cases. However, for most women, you don't need a pap smear after you've had a hysterectomy. If you had an appendicitis and your appendix was removed, you wouldn't get appendicitis again. So theoretically, no, but there are some occasions when we do, and in women who've had uterine, that's of the actual lining of the womb, cancer, we do smears of that area to look for abnormal cells.
Can a woman get cervical cancer after she's had a hysterectomy?
You see, human papillomavirus would not necessarily be cervical cancer, but human papillomavirus also causes vaginal cancer, vulval cancer, anal cancer, head and throat cancer.
Wow.
So it is really about other areas that are affected, but those areas are not as vulnerable as the cervix. There's an area in the vagina where it meets the endometrial lining. And at that junction, we are more vulnerable to these viruses entering the cells below.
Thank you, we're going to take another caller. We've got Anonymous from Johannesburg on the line. Hi, what's your question or comment?
Hi, how are you?
Very well, thank you.
Question for Dr. Thomas. I just received, I don't know why I got an abnormal pap smear result with high-grade CIN2 moderate dysplasia. Recommendation was colposcopic examination. Should I be worried? Because the gynae that I was referred to said he was trying to remove.
Okay, well, this is every woman's fear. We worry, we go for pap smears, and after all, that is why we go, to check whether there are things that aren't seen with the naked eye. So I didn't get the grade of your abnormal pap smear, but if colposcopy is suggested, and a colposcope is basically a big magnifying glass, and some very weak acetic of vinegar, acid is put onto the cervix, and areas that are affected show up as white. And those are the areas that one wants to test to see whether those almost exfoliated cells that were picked up on your pap smear, whether it goes deeper than that. In fact, I think it's very good news that you have had a pap smear which has shown an abnormality, so that one can be way ahead of the curve from the first low-grade abnormality that one can get. Obviously, it's very stressful getting this result. Mm. 90% of changes revert to normal. But if it progresses, you want to check and I'm sure that your doctor will do a co-test, which is DNA test, to check which human papillomavirus is present, because some of them cause changes which aren't actually related to cancer in the long run. So we're way above ahead of the curve by probably a few years, actually, from that first abnormal pap smear. But yes, you must be worried in that you should make an appointment for the suggested examination, but that is exactly why you went to your gynecologist or doctor.
I want you to be a regular on our show. Yeah. Love you, Dr. Thomas.
Thank you for your question, Anonymous. Let's see what the conversation is saying on social media.
Right, it's time for us to turn our attention to how you can win with us on Afternoon Express. Also on our Facebook page, as much as you guys have been giving all your comments through on our question for the day, we also want you guys to share with us on how you and your BFF are getting ready for summer to stand a chance of winning some really cool prizes with Dettol and Afternoon Express. And I wanted to read through some of those comments that we got. One from Ryan, who says, my Dettol Even Tone is wearing matching shirts and being cute. Now, this is the most ridiculous thing I've ever seen in a long time, but it is very, very cool. Thank you so much for sharing that one. This is one of our entries. Another entry that we got was from Motsi Didi, who says, me and my BFF with our bright colour clothes, we're ready for summer. Hashtag Dettol Even Tone. Really cool outfits there, ladies. Looking really, really awesome. Thanks for sharing that one with us. And then Kevin November says, my girlfriend and I get out our hats, sunglasses, summer clothes and sunscreen to prepare for summer. Hashtag Dettol Even Tone. We'd love to hear from you guys. Continue to send through your comments on our page and we'll choose one of those winners very soon on Afternoon Express. If you want to know more details on how to win, here's how.
Keep it even this summer with Dettol Even Tone and stand a chance to win one of four fantastic summer selfie hampers, which include Dettol Even Tone products, an LGX cam phone, and the Striker Pose summer selfie stick. Everything you need for the perfect summer selfie. To enter, simply post a picture on our Afternoon Express Facebook page of how you and your BFF get summer ready using the hashtag Keep It Even. The competition closes on the 28th of October. T's and C's apply and are available on our website.
Welcome back to Afternoon Express. Another sweet moment with us on the show. Today we're making our second dessert. Kelezo's our chef in studio. Let's get making this. It looks so amazing. What is it? Granola?
Granola lemon meringue.
Yummy.
Yummy, yummy, yummy.
I'm keen to learn how to do it.
I am excited to show you how to make an Italian meringue, which is what we're going to do right now. So here I've got some egg white growing into my mixer. Some cream of tartar, that white stuff that, you know, you always have in your cupboard that you never use.
Yes, obviously.
So that I put in there, I let it chill for a second while I focus on this important thing.
Okay.
So I'm gonna make some simple syrup, all right? Mm-hmm. I'm gonna use my Salati Costa Snow. Love this thing, dissolves very quickly so my syrup doesn't burn as I'm cooking.
Yeah, okay, cool.
Cool, so in the pot, maybe you can put some.
Sure, so this goes in this pot here.
That pot right
this.
There.
This.
So that goes in there. Cool. Go for it, puppy.
Done and dusted.
This goes in here, some water to get it going, and then I put that on. Okay.
That is going to cook down.
Let that go until it's soft boil stage. Soft boil. Drop it in. Maybe put a source of water on, but drop a bit of the syrup. If you get a bit of a little ball in there, then that's soft boil stage. Okay. Then that's ready.
I remember you learning about soft boil when it came to fudge making, so that's really
exactly.
Cool.
Exactly. Okay. So, cool. So I get this on, let this go until soft peaks, and then what I've got here, power of TV, there's already some...
Ta-da!
Some syrup. What I'm going to do is add this slowly. So obviously this is not soft peak yet, so add this slowly into this. Let this mix okay. until all the syrup is in.
It looks something like the one that we got over there, right?
It looks just like this one.
Okay, all right. Great.
So what I've got here is my own homemade granola. Mm-hmm. And you can use any granola, have it for breakfast, use it as a cheat for dessert. Pop it at the bottom, lay it. I've got some lemon curd mixed with yogurt.
Okay.
And some fresh blueberries, some of the meringue on top. And it looks like that. You can also do this individually.
Just something to just burn it on top.
Exactly. So we can actually even do this at the table.
It's really nice. We can do that one at the table. So if you guys want to get this recipe and make it for your table this evening, afternoonexpress.co.za is our website. You can go and find the recipe and all the details over there. I think we should go and show the girls how we fire things up in the kitchen, right?
Awesome. Let's do this.
No, you already, you've ruined my day.
Your diet is over, Jeannie. It is done.
You ruined my day. I still love you.
There's something special about to happen there, right?
Yes.
I've
got a blowtorch.
Yay!
Ooh.
Fire.
Ooh.
Which
so this is awesome. What you can do with your guests while you're hosting them for a dinner party, you
if you don't quite like it, you just miss a little bit to like burn a finger or so.
A little party trick.
A little party trick. So you can...
if they're prettier than you, just like take it in the face.
Nobody's prettier than you, Danilo. Thank you so much for joining us today.
You're amazing.
We'll be back again tomorrow. Until then, good night and happy eating. Ciao.
Bye.
It's now meringue time. Give meringue.
Coming up tomorrow on Afternoon Express, international best-selling reggae artist Itana joins us during her tour to South Africa, and we chat to a doctor about how water retention can affect your overall health.
Another feel-good production.